would you guys recommend making more smaller games, 1 to 3 months, instead of few longer games, six plus months? And I think that's, he's talking about development time. Like one.
I think we'll both say the same thing, so I'll let you go first on this one.
I would definitely suggest picking smaller projects, just because there's so much value in getting from start to finish. You know, I mean, I'm sure this is pretty prevalent in our, you know, game development community, and I'm totally someone who's done this. I love starting projects. You know, there's nothing like a clean Unity project where you're pulling in models, everything's clean, everything's under control, and then all of a sudden it starts to get to this thing where you're like, oh, should I add dependency injection? Like, I'm adding a lot of classes here. Should I make a manager? And then to me, you know, that's where it's like, oh, this is kind of getting, like, the fun that I had of the novelty of a brand new project starts to wear thin. And that's where, you know, you tend to just kind of give up or just forget about the project or move on to something else, get distracted. So having projects that are 1 to 3 months, they allow you to see the end goal. And so when you get to those points, and they are inevitable, when you get to those points where the novelty of the project has worn off and you're trying to figure out things that are just so tedious, as an example, maybe you're like, oh, I want to localize my application so that, you know, it's in multiple different languages, or it supports multiple different languages. That's no fun. I mean, come on, you didn't become a game developer to learn how to localize your game, but it's just something that you're going to have to do at some point. So having a game that is short, the concept is simple, you know where the end goal is, it'll allow you to push through those moments, I believe, and get to the end. And the end of a project is, it's really valuable to see that through multiple times, because there's going to be so many things at the end of a project when you're wrapping things up, getting ready to publish, that you will never see if all you do is start projects. And I'm speaking from experience there.
Yeah, there's a million and one good reasons to pick smaller projects over bigger ones. And probably the biggest one is, as Charles said there, and many people will echo, it gets something out of your graveyard of incomplete projects. That happens all of the time, and you really want to avoid that. But even more than that, if you make a small game, it solves a couple of problems. One of them is it helps find the fun early. And I love that phrase, find the fun. I forgot where I read it first, but it basically means that an idea means nothing until you do it in practice. And you can do really quick prototypes, and you can make really small projects, and you can find a fun idea and then run it to the goalpost. Get it as good as it needs to be to prove the idea and move on. And that's why game jams are amazing. Do as many game jams as you possibly can. But basically, you make these small games. Not only that, they teach you how long it takes to make a game. I know that sounds kind of obvious, but like, when you make a game, you can happily say, I'll budget to spend 6 months on my game, and you'll blink and a year's gone by and you're like, oh, okay, I guess I didn't. If you aim for a small game and then it doubles in size, you're losing less worry and time. And on top of all of that, if you work on smaller games, you know whether people like your game, and you're better conditioned to either decide to add more to it later to make a sequel to it or to branch something else. A big mistake I see a lot of people do is they'll make a big game, and even if you succeed in finishing your big game, you don't know that it's fun or not. And what's even worse is it could have been fun to start, but people think that when you release a game that it's going to match what you originally thought of, but you'll change your mind 10 times throughout the process. You'll come up with what the idea is, and by the time you hit the end, the mechanics will have changed, the characters have changed, the goal of the game has changed. It doesn't matter, because as you play it, things will evolve. And if you make it smaller, you can weather those things earlier, and you can avoid one of the biggest dangers of bloat. So it's not just bloat in terms of adding features, but what happens is, and you'll see this a lot in sort of when a studio releases their first game and it took 2-3 years to make, they'll feel like there's a disconnect between the mechanics and either the art or the story or the general feel of the game. Because what's happened is they went in with the goal of making a fast shooter, and then by the end of it, it turned into a cover shooter because they added all of these cover and shield mechanics. And it's because as they're getting into the end of it, they're like, oh, I'll add this feature, I'll add this feature, and this thing is taking ages to debug, so I'll add this new feature. And they'll have lost whatever the point of the story or game or goal was, and the game they end up producing will be probably, you know, it could be for a different audience, or it could be more or less fun than the original starting idea. If you keep it small, you can remember what the fun of your project is and build to that and keep that fun and keep finding it. And you're not in danger of sort of turning into a game that you didn't start with. So small, repetitious cycles of games, and build a good portfolio. The more work you're going to get is the more project you have. And yeah, exactly, feature creep is the kind of specific name, but it boils down to you want a large portfolio of proven good ideas, because gaming isn't just writing the code, and it's not just building the project. Is it fun, and do people want to play it?
Yeah.